about we send texts to Jerry himself? I'm doing a video about how much Jerry sucks. Let's see what he says. Hi, it's me, Aubrey Plaza. So, one thing I really like to do to put myself to sleep is something with my hair. I take my hair I mess with my hair a lot, so this is just one thing I like to do. But I do this all the time when I'm anxious section. And I make a loop like this. And then I put it in my ear. And I listen to it. It talks to me. I'll do the sound into the mic so you can hear. Too, because sometimes when I'm really freaked out, I do two strands in both of my ears, like this. This is really unhealthy for my hair. I'm basically destroying it, but it's worth it, and you know why. So, before I talk about myself, I just want to dedicate this entire video to Molly Shannon, because when we were in Italy, she told me that she's affected by ASMR, specifically this. So Molly, this is for you. I brought my own toys for Molly. This is my makeup bag. That's really loud. Shannon really likes when people rifle through their makeup bags, so I'm gonna do that for her and for you, but mostly for Molly. This is my actual makeup bag. Upright Citizens Brigade Theater. I started UCB when I was 19 years old, and I really wanted to be on a Herald team, which is a long-form improv team, and you have to audition for it. So I auditioned a couple times and got rejected. I like being rejected. It makes me feel alive. And I finally got on a team. After a couple tries, it was called $12,000, which was named after the amount of money that it costs to go through the UCB training program. It's muy expensive. So we made a joke about it. Comedy. I learned a lot of things at UCB. It was a wild time in my life. I had many teachers that I loved. Chris Gethard was one of my teachers. I have so many memories there. One of my favorite memories was we used to do a show where I don't think they legally can do this anymore. This was a long time ago, but we did a show where you had to be legally drunk to perform. You on stage, and if you weren't legally drunk, you had to leave the stage. This is why UCB is the best, and always will be. I don't remember what happened that night, but I'm pretty sure it involved me holding a mic stand, just like this, but there was no microphone, and I was really drunk. Screaming into the mic stand, but no one could hear me because there wasn't this fuzzy friend amplifying my voice to the audience. And I'm pretty sure that Ellie Kemper and I made out on stage. You heard it here first. Ask her. It happened. One of the most famous shows at UCB is called Ass Cat. So I'd like to represent the Ass Cat ASMR for you with some soothing cat sounds. Meow. This is my furry friend. I would like to remind the audience, though, that I do the voice of Grumpy Cat, which is far better than this cat. Is that too loud for you, darlings?
Meow.
NBC page program. Bing, bing, bing. When I graduated from college, I really wanted to work at Saturday Night Live, but the closest I could get was polyester skirt suit and lead studio doors, which I did for a couple months. It didn't work out for me in the page program because people thought I was a witch.
Pretty crazy how I got cast in Funny People.
wasn't a stand-up comedian, but I pretended to be. I took the mic, just like this mic, and I got up on stage, and I did 5 minutes of jokes that I made up, and I had my friend tape it, send it in, and then Judd cast me 2 weeks later. In Los Angeles, I wasn't old enough to rent a car, and I was poor, so I lived in the Days Inn on Hollywood Boulevard for 2 weeks with a bunch of Swedish tourists, and I rented a car from Rent-A-Wreck, which was the only place that would let me rent a car, and I would drive to Sony Studios Sandler's Maserati. I don't know if he had a Maserati, but I just parked next to really expensive cars, and I could barely pay my rent, but I just pretended like it was cool. It was wild. I had never really been in LA, and I didn't know what I was doing, but I just stand-up comedian, and then all of a sudden I was a stand-up comedian because no one knew who I was, so they just assumed that I was a stand-up, and I started getting booked at the Laugh Factory and the Comedy Store and going up in front of live audiences doing comedy even though I had no idea what I was doing. Represent my time as a stand-up comedian when I was on Funny People, I'm going to give you the sounds of a stand-up microphone. I remember this. They're much colder than these ones. I like the sound of as a stand-up comedian. I'll try a different ring. One of my early bits as a stand-up comedian was to just name celebrities and name what kind of tail they would have if they were an animal. For example, Bill Clinton would have a polar bear's nub. Lindsay Lohan would have a bushy squirrel's tail that's long. As a stand-up comedian, I've never seen the inside of the mic before, but it's really boring. It's just a bunch of wires. was so weird that they decided to create the character for me. So, in the original pilot episode of Parks and Recreation, the character of April is actually to my heart, but also I'm much more than that. I was on that show for 7 seasons. I don't know why, but that show has a kind of psychic, beautiful love energy radiating out of it because we all loved each other so much. And you can tell when you watch it. And I think that the show kind of reminds audiences that comedy doesn't have to be mean-spirited. It can come from love. Except we can all still hate Jerry. Because Jerry sucks. Jerry deserves to die. To represent the sounds of texting on my phone, my personal phone. I just like to first show you that I have 2 stickers on my phone. One says, "Hot old guy." And one's a picture of a fox because I like foxes. Okay, now we text. I'll send a text to Jerry himself. I'm typing in Jim O'Hare. Hi, Jim. This is to see if he responds. Say something, Jim. We're all waiting. He's typing right now. I can't wait to see what he says. smiley face. What a dumbass. He really sucks. I'm deleting him from my phone. Ha ha ha. You suck. The TV show Legion. My character on Legion is called Lenny Cornflakes Busker, and it was a very strange process for me to be on this show because the character was originally written for a man, and when I first met with Noah Hawley, he looked at me. I was on crutches at the time because I had torn my ACL playing basketball, and he just said, "What about the role of Lenny?" And I said, "The drug addict, middle-aged man in the mental institution." And he said, "Yes." And I said, "I don't know. That seems weird." Season becomes the Shadow King, which is the villain of the show, and I said, "Sign me up. That sounds fun." So that's what I did. I became a powerful, evil, mutant, psychic villain named the Shadow King. However, in the second season, my character took a very sharp left turn. The Shadow King has relinquished Lenny's body and moved on. So what happens to Lenny? I don't know. It's a very complicated character, but ultimately she's optimistic and is always hoping for the best. She's a tragic character, and I like playing her, but it's emotionally draining sometimes and physically exhausting because I'm being tortured a lot and used by this evil villain, mutant. Sometimes I forget that I'm in the Marvel Universe, but I really like Before I say goodbye to you, my darlings, I'm just gonna clean off the table. There's some little cornflakes bits on the table. All clean. Well, I just wanna say that.